back to another video. This is Motivation for Young Christians. Welcome back. Welcome back to another episode of Bible Study. This is Bible Study episode 50. Today we're going to be diving into John chapter 21 verses 1 through 14. This is the very 50th episode of Bible Study. We're going into the year. I've been posting new Bible Study videos, so I'd like to give a hand of applause to every single body that's participated in these last 50 episodes. Thank you guys so much. Today we'll be led by Brother John. The opening prayer will be done by me, and our closing prayer will be done by Brother Jave. If you guys can, please bow your head and close your eyes. Heavenly Father, we thank you, we praise you, we worship you, God. We thank you for this day that you have made. I rejoice in the end, God. I pray as now as we came together as brother, God, for iron to be able to sharpen iron, God. We pray that we'll be able to pour into each other, God, and we pray that the audience will be able to get the message of today, God. We pray that you'll be able to speak to us, God. We pray that the connections that we need to make, God, we pray that the revelation and all the things that you need to reveal to us will be revealed today, God. We pray that we have a better understanding of your word by the end of this video, God. We love you and we thank you. In Jesus' name, amen. I'm passing it over to Brother John Lee Jr.
Amen. So I'll read our scripture for this today, for this week. Okay, John chapter 21, and I'll be reading verses 1 through 14 in the New Living Translation. Okay, it says, later, Jesus appeared to the disciples beside the Sea of Galilee. This is how it happened. Several of the disciples were there, Simon, other disciples. Simon, what they called nothing all night. At dawn, Jesus was standing on the beach, but the disciples couldn't see who he was. He called out, "Fellows, have you caught any fish?" "No," they replied. Then he said, "Throw out your net on the right-hand side of the boat and you'll get some." So they did, and they couldn't haul in the net because there were so many fish in it. Then the disciple Jesus loved said to Peter, "It's the Lord." When Simon Peter heard that it was the Lord, he put on his tunic, for he had stripped for work, jumped into the water and headed to shore. The others stayed with the boat and pulled the loaded net to the shore, for they were only about 100 yards from shore. When they got there, they found breakfast waiting for them, fish cooking over a charcoal fire and some bread. "Bring some of the fish you've just caught," Jesus said. So Simon Peter went aboard and dragged the net to the shore. And there were 153 large fish, and yet the net hadn't torn. Now come and have some breakfast," Jesus said. None of the disciples dared to ask him, "Who are you?" They knew it was the Lord. Then Jesus served them the bread and the fish. This was the third time Jesus had appeared to his disciples since he had been raised from the dead. And the word has been read. Let's dig in.
Amen, amen. As I was reading this last night, the first scripture that pointed out to me was verses 6. And to me, that represents how Jesus said that he'll provide all our needs. And here in the verse, you see that Jesus provided the need for his disciples by providing them the large fish that was caught in the net. And then later we found out in verses 11, it was 153 large fishes. So that's the first thing that pointed out to me, that Jesus was able to provide the needs of his men. And the same thing relates to us now. Jesus will always provide our needs and sometime once.
It's good. I think in reading this, for a while, the word blueprint has been on my mind. And I think Jesus, when you read the scriptures and you read the gospels, that Jesus gives us a blueprint on how to do something. We are used to doing it one way, but here he says to the disciples, cast your net on the other side. And this wasn't the first time he told them about this, right? And I believe that's part of why they said, "Oh, it's the Lord," and they ran. Because remember when they were fishing in the beginning, and Jesus asked them to become fishers of men, they were out at sea fishing, right? But their efforts was futile. They couldn't catch any fish. And Jesus said to them, "Cast their boat on the other side." They did so, and their net was so full. They pulled it on the boat. It was so much fish, right? So Jesus is always laying out what I would like to call the blueprint, right, of how to do something. And as you follow his intended blueprint or his guidance, you will see that you will flourish in that which you are doing. So that was one of the things that stood out to me just from the beginning.
You know what jumps out to me, I guess, I don't know, for some odd reason, I'm not sure. It's just the fact they were able to just go back to life in the beginning. And even still supporting everything that you guys have said so far. It's like, all right, so we've walked with the Savior for as long as they were able to. And it just so happened that, okay, now he's gone. He's gone. He's came. He's delivered his message. He's done what he said he would do. And now he's gone back to the Father. And it just, I don't know, for me, it, I don't know, maybe age kicking in, I don't know. But now that Jesus is gone, they're able to get back to life. They're able to go into life. But the thing is, I like about it is they're not forgetting what the principles were that the Lord had given them. I mean, even to the point that, you know, someone's just asking them, hey, did you catch anything? And, you know, they just know how to still walk in what the Lord gave them. And they're like, nah, we ain't catch anything. And even just follow the advice of someone that at least they might not know it was Jesus at the time, but even to say, well, just put your net on the other side. And they knew, hey, let's go ahead and follow this and go with it. And of course it manifested. And I love the excitement once they realize, hey, this is the Lord. And they follow. And I sometimes think of it, even like I said, supporting what Jave is saying about overall the blueprint. I think even with the blueprint too, sometimes like I think of the scripture and so many times we hear this preached, you know, cast your net on the other side, cast your net on the other side. And it's always a reminder of strategy. I mean, the Lord always have been a person of strategy. And even for us as believers, we got to remember that the Lord gives us methods and he gives us a blueprint for what it is to be. But the strategy sometimes will change. The way that you reach fish maybe 50 years ago is not the same way you reach fish now. But the thing is this, the blueprint never changed. The way and the outcome as far as souls, the way and the outcome as far as preaching of the gospel has never changed, but the way you do it, that may have been. I remember even thinking of it, like there's that old story I talk about growing up of the woman that cooked her pot roast in two pans. All she knew was every time she made a pot roast, it had to go in two pans. Didn't question it, but she knew whenever she would make it, I had to have two pans. I had to cut it and put it in two pans. And then one day, someone had to ask the question, why do you put the pot roast in two pans? Or excuse me, she asked her mother, why she put it in two pans? And she pretty much had to tell her, well, the only reason why it was cut because it wasn't a pan that was big enough. So we're pretty much even to go forth. There is a way to get to the method, but there could be a different strategy. And I just love the method here of reminding us, check your strategy. I mean, you might have always caught fish on the left. Perhaps it's time to switch the strategy to the right and go forward from there. And then, of course, recognizing, hey, it's the Lord in all things. Yeah. The way you did things in the past could be different the way we do things now, but it's still the Lord that's on the side of the shore to call us from there. I stop for now.
Yeah. And just to, I guess, follow up on that, Brother John, do you think we as a body, COGOP specifically, do you think we have yet cast the net on the other side?
I think we've begun to. And I definitely want to jump to not just immediately saying no, because I have seen some things begin. Or rather, I'll say I've seen some, I guess, as far as our movement, there's many boats within the ship,
yeah.
Put it that way. Some boats have begun to cast on the other side. Some boats are still looking to still go on the left and see what's there. But I definitely think we're not where we used to be. As far as, and I'll even just make that personal from my time. I came to prophecy when I first went to college. That was like 20 years ago at this point. And I've definitely seen some changes since I've come in. But we have, there's many other side of the nets that we need to do. I'll put it that way. Yes, I do feel that we made some progress, but there's a lot we need to do. There's a lot that we feel is still on the left, but we got to understand that God never changes strategy. He never changes blueprint. He never changes design, but the way we do, we have to change to the other side with the net.
Absolutely.
Amen. And I wanted to point out in the scripture that once Jesus spoke to them, they didn't even question whether if that was Jesus or not. Later, after they did it, they was like, okay, that's Jesus. But my thoughts from that is being able to have the voice of God be familiar with you, where once you hear it, you don't have to question whether that's the voice or not. Once you hear it, you'll be like, that's the Lord. It's kind of like, I could close my eye right now, and if either Brother Jave or Brother John talk, I could know already which one of them is talking, because I'm familiar with the voice. And by building a relationship with God and Jesus, you become familiar with the voice. You need to get to that point, because once you hear that voice, you won't be like, who that? You know what? That might be Brother John or Brother Jave. I don't really know like that. But you gotta, as you grow more, as you connect more, the voice is gonna become familiar to you, and that's my thought that came from my head just now.
That was good. That was wrong. That's good. Another thing, too, that stood out to me was verse 13. Jesus just really embodies servanthood, right? Peter, you know, the disciples, they wanted to prepare food for him, right? They wanted him to have breakfast, and yet it says here, then Jesus had served them the bread and the fish. Just a true servant, right? That, you know, he says in his word, I don't remember the exact scripture, but he come not to be served, but to serve, right? He just continues to embody servanthood, and I think that's so important for us, not just as leaders, but as men of God, as children of God, that we continue to serve and embody and be the example that Jesus set for us, right? That we can't, especially as leaders, can't get so big and bold that we forget to serve, right? That's exactly what he has called us to do, right? Not to just preach and sing and you know, lead Bible study and, you know, expand our platform, but to serve his people. Right. And again, here he embodies servanthood.
This is very important, because I always say, in order to lead my body, you have to serve. Because Jesus set out the blueprint, going back to Brother John, he set out the blueprint to show us what we need to do. We need to follow that blueprint. In order to lead, you have to serve. Even though this leadership position, I've been in it for a couple of years now, I still serve. I still know that I'm not this big person, that I don't get too boastful, because I still serve. I still make sure that I play my part, even though that I'm in a leadership position. And yeah, just in order to lead, you have to serve. You can't forget the serve part in the leadership.
You know what I like too, actually, about the part with Jesus seeing the, being at the side, even making breakfast. I see it even beyond the serving aspect. As important as it is, I see it as the life aspect. It wasn't just work. Jesus was not just about work, 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 serve, 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 lead, lead, lead. But he also lived. I mean, this is the Savior being able to come together with his disciples, come together with his boys, and just say, all right, bring that fish over here and let's sit down. And I would love to know, I wonder what they talked about. I mean, what was the fullness of the conversation? Because I'm sure it wasn't necessarily all just the Lord speaking the parables. And we do see going forward, he did speak with them about how to serve and how to go from there. And I'm pretty sure that's Bible study 51. But they had a conversation and just lived. And I think sometimes that's something we have to remember as believers. It's not just you serving, but it's you living. That's definitely been ringing in my heart lately, is don't just serve. Don't just come to church. Don't just be, you know, I don't want to say stuck in the Bible, because I don't believe we're stuck in the Bible, but the Bible is always a place for wisdom, teaching, correction, the whole gamut, but learn how to live. So the Lord lived. He lived life, and they were able to come and commune together. Sometimes we can get too saved that we don't know how to fellowship. We don't know how to live together. We don't know how to, you know, it's not like you get saved and you can't play ball no more. Sometimes you preach better on the court than you do in the church. I mean, you do better when you're doing hair together than you do when you're in worship team practice. Sometimes you do better when you're washing the car than you do when you're actually singing in the choir. There's so many other different things that you can do to become effective in ministry. And even in just this simplistic moment of having Jesus cook fish, I'm sure minister to them in such an impactful way than just a sermon. And we have to remember, we can't just do, are you saying hallelujah? We can't just do the church work, but we got to do the life work too. We got to be able to touch each other's lives as well. Plus, Jesus liked food, so I love Jesus even more. Thank you, Jesus. My mother found Roger Faken. He served fish and bread. That's why every Good Friday, you must serve fish and bread. Every Friday. I'll pick your brain. All right, Maya, you just want to make an appearance for a moment. I wonder, what was the impact of his multiple appearances? Like, I never really wrestled with it with verse 14. This was the third time Jesus appeared to his disciples since he had been raised from the dead. And I don't know. Probably something that we can even tackle today, but it was just, what was on his mind behind the third appearance? Like, what? And I even think about even the appearances all throughout. And I wonder if it's just, and I guess it kind of touches even to what Ezra was saying. It's not just recognizing his face, but recognizing his voice, or even recognizing his presence. Okay, maybe I answered my own question. So it's just that people would know and understand his presence, but that's something to wrestle into.
Has you got nothing else? Anything else?
Nothing as of now, but I was writing down what Brother John was saying and what I said before. I'm making sure that I take my notes now. Thank you, Brother Gio.
I got a favorite moment to throw out, though, from verse 7. I don't know, maybe this, I keep reading it. I do have to give Peter a shout out for putting his tunic back on and jumping in the water. I have to give him props for that. Like, I don't know. We always talk about Peter too. I mean, there's a lot of excitement, a lot of good things to learn from him. I mean, he knew it was the Lord and left everything behind, threw on his clothes and just went after it and be like, hey, God. Hey,
I think that's good too. That's actually really good. I like that. As you said, Brother John, he left what he was doing and just jumped up and ran to the Lord. And as you said, there's so many things we can learn from Peter, right? We could preach that whole verse right there, right? Of leaving everything behind and running to the Lord. And though Peter has made so many mistakes, that relationship, right? He recognizes his savior. He recognizes the one that he's walked with for so long and served with, and immediately he stopped what he was doing and ran to him. And I think, as you said, Brother John, that sets a great example for us, that we can't get so busy with work that we miss God. We can't get so busy serving or ministering or preaching or pastoring that we miss God. And we also have to know where God is, right? God wasn't necessarily in the water, he was on the shore, right? And so we have to constantly be where his presence is and not be so caught up with the regular things of life, the work and the ministry, but actually be where Jesus is.
Yeah, I'm gonna say my last words and get, I'm gonna take what Jave said just now and start trouble. Okay. So I know we had a question earlier about are we casting our nets to the other side yet? I think a bigger problem is, are we missing that his presence is there and moving in a different way? And I'll drop that particular one, because a lot of times we get too caught up on what the program says or what we feel the service needs to be rather than what the Spirit is doing. And I'll leave that there.
And leave that there. But I could relate to what you said, Brother Jave. Because sometimes I get so busy with everything I do. Once you hear the call, it's just like, hold on, let me get this finished. And I'm gonna go over there and do what you got need me to do, God. And I have to work on that. So I say that's one thing that I have to work on. Sometimes I get so busy with everything else I'm doing, I'm forgetting to answer the call. But with Peter, even though he made a lot of mistakes, there's a lot to be learned from him. And what verse was that again? That
seven.
Was verse seven. Yeah, and then verse 7 is a perfect example. He left what he was doing. He went, put on his clothes, went straight to Jesus, and I have to say, I have to work on that. Anytime I hear the call, I didn't stop what I'm doing and go straight to the source. But also relating to what you said, Brother Sean, I do also agree with that too, because I've seen how people have been so strict on like the program or like the service, and just instead of just laying out work, God don't work in hard time. He work in his own time. So we always have to remember that when the Spirit moves, we need to let the Spirit move.
Not, you know, I think that's a separate conversation, because it could be lengthy, right? I think, as you know, we're program led and not necessarily Spirit led. But I think part of it too is we have to teach our people, right? How to become sensitive per se to the Spirit's leading, right? How to be up there but still in tune with what the Holy Spirit is doing. I think a lot of it, not to go off on a tangent, is that we emphasize so much the power and not the person. And so a lot of us don't understand or know the person. We've just heard of the power. And so if we're always looking for this demonstration of power per se, right, when we have not spent time with the person. And I think that's where it needs to start, especially in our young people, right? Because that's the same problem I realized that happened with me. Like, I only knew about the power. That's all that was emphasized, the power, but not the person. And as a result, if we're not careful, we'll miss the person and always looking for the power. And I think that's part of the issue. But, you know, that's such a deeper conversation than we probably have time for now. And I think, you know, probably need some more deeper conversation.
It's a deeper conversation that we definitely can have. And also relating back to you, I was talking about the power, not the person. It was emphasized the power. The power of the Holy Spirit, what he can do, not talking about the person. But we could definitely dive into that one video. I will dedicate a whole video. Let's talk about it. Let's learn about the Holy Spirit to be able to educate the youth, but everybody else around the world, because I'm pretty sure that same teaching of the power have been taught a whole bunch of places instead of the person. So we can definitely get into that one video. Not this video, because that's going to be lengthy. That's a very strong and powerful conversation, but we will definitely have that conversation.
Needed.
Absolutely.
It is. It's needed. Once we recognize we have to make change or add an adjustment, we need to do it, because it's all coming out the benefit of God, because us learning about the person will better help us to understand how to be led by him instead of focusing on our program. Because, like, for example, I mean, sometimes I may have something planned out for the day, but then Jesus tells me, you know what, dude, I need you to do this other thing. And I also have to work on that too, because usually I like to just stick to what I'm doing because I have it organized. I know what I got to do. It works best for me. But then I'm forgetting that God is not going to ask me to do something that's out of my capability. He's not going to ask me to do something that's not going to help me. So we also have to make sure we get to that too. Because being led by the Spirit, I've seen so much amazing words being spoken, so much amazing action just being led by the Spirit over my years in church. And once that Spirit moves, things go crazy. Deliverance is crazy.
Really, it comes down to, even with the scripture we're talking about today, it comes down to obedience. I mean, obedience and relationship. I mean, you have to know who's talking to you, know who you're listening to, and know what you want to do with what they're saying. I mean, even with what we're, I don't even want to say tangent because it's not really a tangent. I think it flows right in line. When we speak about Holy Spirit, you know, we want to be able to obey and know we hear him. Oh, prophesy, daughter, prophesy. Mm-hmm. But know that, you know, it's him and that he leads us. And I like even in this scripture here that we're referencing today, they heard a voice. They need to obey the voice, and then they saw the blessing with it. It wasn't just, okay, some guy said throw your net. But when they threw the net, there was a manifestation. They had a relationship with the voice that was speaking to them, had a relationship with the person that was speaking to them, and they saw the result. And even sometimes, even we can even talk about church. Sometimes we can get caught up in the manifestation and not the work that was done behind it. I've always said, to me, and I'll stop my tangent because I'll be done start. To me, just hearing one of us speak in tongues, that's not it. That's not it. I'm glad for the manifestation of his presence moving upon you, but what has it done after your tongue is done? What's happened on the inside? I mean, like I said, it's really more an emphasis now on not moving or relying on the Holy Spirit for a powerful demonstration, but what is he imparting into us that we live outside of that? Help sustain us to live. That's really the meat of the things. I think that's what really causes us to keep following Jesus. And that's definitely something that we need to do as far as learning and following the Holy Spirit. Holy Spirit, I need to have a better relationship with you, that I will follow you no matter what I feel. And I digress. Mute. I just gave you about 5 series right there.
Right.
I'll make my disclaimer. The Holy Ghost do more than make you speak in tongues and jump. If he can't stop you from speaking the other tongue, will somebody tick you off? Amen.
Amen. Amen. Any more thoughts, any more opinion, any more revelation of the weight of today?
I need Jesus. I need the Holy Ghost. I need to cast my net on the other side too. Thank you, Lord.
Amen.
Amen. The message for today is cast your net on the other side. Sorry, message for today. Cast your net on the other side. Thank you guys so much for your thoughts, opinions, revelations to be able to speak on the scripture. Now we're going into our closing prayer, which will be done by Associate Pastor Jave.
Father, we bless you. We honor you. We thank you, God, for another opportunity to gather here on Zoom just to discuss your word. We thank you for continuing to use Ezron in this ministry that you have given him. May you continue to bless it. We thank you for Brother John that was able to join in as well. We pray, oh God, that you would continue to be with us as we study. We pray, God, that we will take with us what you have revealed and what we have discussed, whatever we have learned today, that we'll take it, we'll apply it. Help us, oh God, to be obedient. Help us, oh God, to recognize when your presence is moving, and give us the obedience. Help us to be obedient to move when you move. Stay connected in terms of relationship, but also fellowship. So, Lord, we thank you for what you've done. Help us, oh God, no matter what, to always recognize your voice. We honor you. We bless you, God. We thank you. We pray, God, that when others watch this study, that they too will receive something from today. God, that you will prepare even now the heart and the minds to receive, oh God, from this study. So we leave everything in your hands, and we thank you again in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen, amen, amen. Thank you guys so much for coming along on another episode of Bible Study. This was the 50th episode of Bible Study. As I mentioned earlier, we're going into a year of doing Bible study, which I thank God so much for us to be able to start this ministry online to continue to educate everybody. So thank you so much to the Lord for that. This was the end of this video. Today we were able to dive into John chapter 21, verses 1 through 14 to talk about the message, the word, and we ended off with the message of casting your net on the other side. Always remember that, be focused on that. Continue to learn more about the God. Continue to learn more by his word and learn about the Holy Spirit. We need to learn about the person and focus less on the power. But don't worry, I'll have a video coming soon discussing about that to educate you more on that. Thank you guys so much for watching the video again. This is Motivation for Young Christians. I'll see you guys next week in another video. Make sure you like, subscribe. Bye.